Merhaba. That's also 50% of all my Turkish. Even though I spend a lot of time here visiting Istanbul and also going on vacation in Göcek over the last years, I really haven't learned a lot of Turkish. It's merhaba and it's teşekkürler. Even though some people here talk to me in Turkish because I guess I look Turkish, which I think is a compliment. The thing is, I'm here to talk about virtual reality a little bit and about our company and why our company has chosen with Jaunt to do this. Jaunt is an English word and it means a short trip away, let's say, excursion into another place. And virtual reality, of course, it's a description of an other kind of reality, which we do with different kind of devices. And we will show you some of them at the end of the program when I'm done. There's different ways to experience virtual reality, and they're all available right now in a store near you. It almost sounds like it. So first of all, thanks very much. It's a pleasure and an honor to be here in Istanbul with you today. And you're here in such large numbers. Let's talk a little bit about virtual reality, and I'll try to make it a little bit fast because it's been a long day for all of you. And I think everybody wants to go and have a drink and go for kebab. Let's go. So a little bit about our company, just so you know the background. It's a very mixed international company. The original founders are Jens Christensen, on the top left, from Denmark, and Arthur van Hoff, the CTO, are the two founders. And Arthur and Jens have worked together previously on a company which they sold to Flipboard a few years ago. Maybe you know this app for the iPad and iPhone called Flipboard. And they have a long history of successful companies. Arthur has taken a company public. He sold one to Dell Computers. He sold another company to TiVo. So they have a very long history, actually, in Silicon Valley, even though they are originally European. And a few years ago, they were wondering what to do next, actually 2 years ago. And somebody showed Arthur the demo for the Oculus Rift, which is this device over here, which was then on Kickstarter. And he put it on, and the image quality was terrible. It was very blocky, very pixelage, and it didn't look like a lot of fun. He thought it was weird. And then when he took off the headset, he realized that outside the whole office had gone dark. Because actually what had happened is he had taken it, had put it on so long that it had gone dark outside. And then he realized that he had really been away, even though he didn't like the technical quality, that the experience was so strong that he really wanted to do something in this. And that's how they started. And then we raised money from various investors, which I'll get to, but they increased the team with people like David Enderman and Cliff Plumer, who used to be, and Miles Perkins, at Lucasfilm. And Lucasfilm, of course, is famous for creating Indiana Jones and Star Wars, so making big Hollywood productions. But for example, Cliff, who's now head of our movie studio, was in charge of all the animations and all the computer-generated images in the movie Titanic. So in Titanic, remember when you see the scene where Kate goes like this on the front of the boat? That was all Cliff. That was not Kate. And some of our investors you may have heard of. Google Ventures is one of our earliest investors. Sky, the British TV company. Paul McCartney is the Beatle. Became a shareholder and investor and a big fan also. Maybe you know the Oscar-winning actor Jared Leto, a singer and actor. And there's people from IMAX, and there's a large group of international investors. Last month, we raised a $65 million funding round. It's about, I think, 200 million Turkish lira. And we raised it from companies like Disney in the US, from a German TV production company ProSieben, and from China Media Capital. So we really have a global investor base across Europe, Asia, and the US, and a very international team. And the reason these people have invested is basically that they all think that VR will be something big. And what we try to do in VR, which is short for virtual reality, is to bring cinematic VR experience. So we don't make games, we don't do computer-generated images, but we do real-life experiences, like we are here together, and film that, and turn that into a movie, into short clips. So we actually say that we bring reality to virtual reality. And this is what virtual reality used to look like. And you may remember this. This is Christopher Walken. This is what virtual reality was like 20 years ago in movies. It was a big helmet, very heavy, and it was expensive, it was slow, it wasn't real, no video, but just computer images. And this is what VR looked like in popular culture. And it was something that was and is very hard to do. You've seen, if you have walked around here today, and you'll see it over the next few days, many different VR applications. And what you notice is how much time these people have spent in making those. It is, the background is in military applications and in research applications, all CG, computer-generated images. And the headsets, as you just saw, see this one also, is very big. It's very heavy. And that's what it was like for, until basically 2 years ago. And then this happened. A 21-year-old student from California called Palmer Luckey, he developed on the, what you see on the left, the Oculus Rift, which is this device. And he put it on Kickstarter. He put it together in his own garage, and he built it basically from components from ski goggles. He built it from other little pieces of electronics that he put together just because he was a big fan of VR and he wanted to see what was possible with the current technology. And then he raised a lot of money on Kickstarter, and before you know it, Mark Zuckerberg from Facebook bought his company, Oculus, for $2.3 billion before Palmer had even shipped one Oculus Rift. So before the product was on the market, he sold the company for more than $2 billion. And that exploded the whole market. When Facebook took VR serious is when the world started paying attention. And that's also when Google countered by making this little device called the Google Cardboard. The Google Cardboard costs something like, I think, 30 Turkish lira. You can buy it anywhere. It's basically a piece of cardboard with two little plastic lenses in it. But if you put your phone in it, it becomes a VR experience. So you can just put your phone in there, download, for example, the Jaunt app, which is free, on iPhone or Android. You put it in, and you can use it like this. Now I look like an idiot, but that's VR. Look like an idiot, but enjoy it. And it becomes a whole thing. This thing just costs 30 Turkish lira, just with your own phone. So that's what happened. And suddenly, HD displays, so the display technology that do the image, became a lot cheaper. The processors became a lot cheaper because they used processors that were built in mobile phones. So the mobile phones have made the processors so cheap because there are billions of those produced. And that's suddenly when there's two big companies pushing VR. There's Google with the cardboard, and there's Oculus. And last month, I maybe have heard, New York Times distributed 1.2 million of those cardboards in the New York Times and then made an app freely available for download, which I highly recommend that you try and download it. And the cardboard you can just order online at many places. If you type in Google Cardboard, you can get it anywhere. So many companies are making those for, like I said, around 30 Turkish liras. So suddenly now, things changed. Everybody thinks now that, especially Mark Zuckerberg, of course he had to say this, he just spent $2.3 billion on buying a company, so he's not gonna say, oh, it's just a joke. He's gonna say, mobile is the platform of today, the cell phones. Now we're getting ready for the platforms of tomorrow. And Facebook is really betting that the next big platform will be VR. So your timeline that you know in Facebook, when you log into Facebook and you see what your friends have posted, you have now also already seen some experiments, and we'll introduce this soon, when the Oculus becomes available to the public markets in March and April, you will see Facebook come up with VR timelines. In your timeline, there will be special headlines for VR videos. And Facebook will push this platform very hard. So it originated with gaming and military applications, as I said, but it's the problem with gaming on VR is you need a very, very strong PC, a big one. You need a very strong graphics card. You need handheld controllers, and it's expensive. It's expensive to make games for VR, and some of those, the cheapest games to do are like $30 million, but quickly they go to $300 million to produce a good VR game that's multiplayer. And making videos for VR cinematic, like Jaunt is trying to do, is a lot cheaper and it's a lot easier to do. Not that easy, because otherwise everyone would do it, but it's easier. Cinematic VR has a bigger market, we feel, than gaming, for a very simple reason. There's more people that watch videos than play computer games. It's very easy to use for consumers. There's a mass appeal across all demographics, meaning women, older people, everybody can look at VR streaming video content. And we feel that mobile is the next delivery platform. Yes, there will be people that will use, let's say, this device. In the beginning, probably younger men. The expectancy is maybe between 30 to 50 million of those devices will be sold. By Sony for the PlayStation, by Facebook, the Oculus, by HTC, and you'll probably see other companies, maybe a big company named after a fruit is going to make one in about a year and a half to 2 years, because they're now hiring all kinds of developers. And once Apple makes one, it will really explode. But right now what you see is everybody making those headsets, and at the same time, even if they sell 50 million, cell phones are over 4 billion people using those. So the market for VR on headsets, on handsets and just on phones, is so much bigger than on the skiing goggle-like helmets. So what we did is this. We built this camera that you see over there. It's built on GoPros. This was the first thing we built 2 years ago. It has a rig of 8 GoPros in a 3D printed plastic housing. And it had a lot of problems because it was difficult to do, because you get 8 different images that you have to stitch together. I'll show more about it. The thing about it that if you do it better with a better camera, which I'll get to, we think it can be really transformative, like especially for music. VR works extremely well for music and for music performances, because it feels like you're right there. You don't have to be in the audience anymore. The camera can be next to Paul McCartney on the piano, like we have shot. And that's an app you can download for free for Android and for iPhone. And suddenly Paul McCartney sits next to you and he looks at you in the eye instead of you being in the audience very far away. And it makes a completely different experience, which will make some people try after my talk. And we've done a few of those. Also in movies, in film, especially short films, VR works. It's difficult to do for many reasons. There are no close-ups. The camera stands there. There's no cameraman. You see here this movie? Some of these people here that you see there, the problem was that's a cameraman with a baseball cap, but he was always standing in the shot, and it was a war movie with Germans fighting Americans, and it's very difficult to have a guy with a baseball cap standing in the shot. And with virtual reality, if you're in the shot, you're always in the shot. You cannot hide behind the camera because it's filming in 360. So in the end, what we had to do there is dress up the cameraman as German soldiers. So the cameraman that's running at you is actually a German soldier, or a German soldier is the cameraman, but it's very difficult to make VR films because of it. You have to really put the camera there and go away and let the actors do their thing. In sports, we've done some things, so we'll announce it soon, in big, especially in American football. It's different because you can put a different perspective on it, and it feels like you're in the stadium. So it sort of replicates the stadium experience for you while you're at home, or in the metro, or maybe somewhere else, walking down the street, or maybe not walking, sitting on a terrace, having a coffee, or a Turkish tea. And that's when you can feel like you're in the stadium. And travel has been the biggest success so far. Travel is really the ultimate virtual reality experience, because it makes you go to places that you could normally never go. We've done shots at the Great Barrier Reef in Australia, on top of the Mount Everest. You see some things where people fly down the Grand Canyon with a parachute. Things that you may want to do, but you probably never will, but you can now experience from the comfort of your own living room. And that's something else. What you also see is in news. We haven't done much yet. Sky News and ABC have just been into Syria and in Iraq filming news content. But news is usually timely, and since this is not live, it takes production work after filming. It's more for documentaries than for real-life news from up-to-the-minute live. Retail and advertising is, of course, where everybody is looking. We had a reception yesterday at the Dutch consulate, and there were people from the advertising world there. We did things with North Face, an American apparel brand, and what they do is in the stores, they put people the headset on, and they can see all the content. They can see the Mount Everest, and they can see people down in the Grand Canyon, and basically experience what the clothing will be used like in real life. It gives people a better feeling of North Face, makes them happier, and the engagement that advertisers strive for is really strong in VR. Now, we have created something called John Studios. We are now a company in Palo Alto with 60 people building the technology. We have 20 people in Santa Monica in the studios, and it doesn't mean that these 20 people are actually making films. What we do is we work together. This is Oscar winner Alejandro Iñárritu, and a lot of other creative people we work with, that we give the technology to make the best content. Our goal is not to become a technology company. Our goal is to become a content company like Netflix. So we are trying to amass a lot of rights from the best creative people, and that in the future maybe, now everything is for free, maybe in the future like Netflix will charge a subscription, or like Spotify, where you can get a lot of content, and every month you pay 30 Turkish lira to get a subscription. We want to make at least 1,000 VR movies a year, to give you an idea of our ambitions. We're making hundreds of those cameras. So in VR, we try to get a competitive edge by getting the best technology out there to develop the best content. So technology is our differentiator, but it's not the end goal. This is the camera that brought a lot of attention in the beginning, and this is from this last 12 months. There's a lot of interest in VR in general, and usually we're perceived as the leader, so there's a lot of interest from international media. And VR is getting really big. You cannot basically look at a news show right now or technology show and there's VR in it. There's Jens and Cliff and Arthur, our leadership, always talking about VR. Now, the technology, to go into the details a little bit, because I know there's a lot of people here from the innovation world, from the technology world. The unique technology is that we basically use calibrated panoptic cameras, which are three buzzwords together. But it means that the cameras work together in sync. That's important. We use computational algorithms, which means, for example, for the stereo, it's computational stereo that we actually compute where the sound comes from. So it goes a little bit like this. Let's say you're watching a clip and there's a girl on the left and a guy on the right. If the girl on the left starts talking to you, you actually hear her on the right side of your headphone. The guy that talks to you on this side, you will hear from the left. So everything is 3D audio and it's spatial. And that makes it very, very real. The sound is almost as important as the video in virtual reality. The fact that the sound comes from the person really talking to you like we are talking now, and actually like I'm talking to you now, but not amplified all over an audience. It really comes from the directions. This was actually, it said prototype, when we made this, it was still the prototype, but it became this camera. This is called the Jaunt 1. The way it was built, I'm gonna slide over here. As you can see, this camera actually consists of 24 different cameras. This is one camera that goes in here, and there's 16 that go in the round, 4 go in the top and 4 in the bottom. In total, there are 24 cameras in one camera. So our cameras are very difficult and expensive to make, because when we say one camera, it's really 24 cameras. And a GoPro has a 1/4-inch sensor. The sensors we use from Sony are 1-inch Sony sensors, which is 4 times the qualities of a GoPro. And it has a 110 degrees field of vision, which means that it's filming everybody. If we're filming here, if we have the camera here, it would film straight, it films around, 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 and it glues the picture together. If you look at it like this, this is what it looks like in real life. It's cut from pieces of aluminum by a robot. It's hard work. This is what it does then afterwards. Once we have shot those 24 images, our algorithm actually makes one image out of it. This is real, this is not simulated. This was a shot we made. You can see that on the left, the sky is a little light blue, mid blue, let's say. You go to the right, it gets dark blue, and the far right shot is light blue again. So then, if you would be watching this in one of the devices, it would be like little blocks, like Lego. And what our software does, it removes the lens distortion, it precisely aligns the images that they're all, the horizon is equal and even, it computates the color consensus, and then it stitches one big panorama. So it feels like you're actually standing there. If you would see an image from the top, you would never feel like it was real. But if you see it like the bottom, you think you're actually standing near the Golden Gate. So that is the secret sauce. How do you do that, and how do you do it quick? So the way we do it is, we build a complete software solution from front to back. This is gonna go in a little bit of detail, but since you're here still anyway, the camera, basically I just explained, once the camera is done, it shoots 24, ooh, did I go too far? I go back. I don't know what happened there. I go to this one. The camera uploads the image, 24 different ones. You get them on your laptop first. On your laptop, just like this one, you can do a quick rendering. So the director can basically see, okay, I like this, I wanna use these shots. Then he uploads it to the cloud over the internet. And in the cloud, we do the rendering. The rendering is actually done on servers that we run on Amazon. And the interesting thing about it is, then we shoot back one file with 24 tracks, 24 images, to the director. So the director can use the regular Final Cut Pro and regular production tools and Adobe Premiere, whatever he likes. He can use whatever he wants, he or she, to then optimize and edit the stuff. Then once one content piece is created, he then uploads it back into the cloud, and we distribute that piece of content all over the world. It goes to cell phones like this, it goes into the cardboard, it goes to laptops, it goes on the Rift, on all the platforms that are out there, and currently there's at least 7. Sony has got a platform, Facebook, Oculus has got a platform, iPhone, Android, all these different platforms we have created applications for. So it's one piece of content that we distribute. Now, the app environment will release this soon. It will be different. When you put on one of these things and you select the content, it's not going to be like a screen where you click, but it will be actually be an environment where you're standing in. So if you're in the sports section, you're actually standing in a stadium, and by looking at something for 3 seconds, you can select. And this is what a new navigational menu for VR looks like. Now, what we do is create this kind of stuff. Let's see how people react to that. This is how fans react when they see VR for the first time.
My head spins, I'm pressed against the wall, just watching your every move. You're way too cool and you're coming this way, coming this way.
So, since we have the setup and I'm done with the talk, this is sort of an overview of what VR does. Who wants to see something in VR? And then we'll see how we react to that. Let's see if somebody for the audience wants to participate. I have lined up 2 videos. One is something from travel, and one is a horror movie. All right, gentlemen, if you want to come to the front. Come on up. This is all a safe environment. These are 5,000 of your closest friends. So, hi, nice to meet you, I'm Michael.
Nice to meet you, my name is Yahya.
Hi. If you sit down, I'll put the headset on you. If you sit over there, which one do you like? You like the travel or the horror? You like the horror? Okay. It's never too scary. All right, if you sit down, lean back. I'll fly this one on. Is it comfortable? All right, let's go. Just sit down and look around you. You can just look straight, okay? Yeah, you good? What do you see?
John.
Here we go, all right.
Can you hear me? I think they slipped us something.
Can you turn up the audio? Can you turn up the audio? And was it scary?
That's very, very scary.
Can you turn this microphone on, this one? Look at this handset, guys. Look at this one and look at this my headset. Could you put this handset on? I like to ask him a question. What do you think?
Yeah, it's fantastic. Amazing. It's very, very scary movie. Yeah, thank you very much.
did you think you were in a garage? Because this was actually just you sitting in a garage. There was really nothing that scary.
Yeah, of course, of course.
But did it look real, or what did you think of it?
It will be inside in the movie, like 3D, but most than 3D. It's better.
All right. Thanks
thank
a lot.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate it.
Nice to meet you.
Thanks. All right. Who wants to come up for the travel? Let me get
check
a girl. We just had a guy. 1 second. All right, come on up.
I think you made a wrong decision. You took a Turkish man for a horror movie.
Yeah, I know.
And wanted to see him skate in front of this public.
Here you go.
That will not ever happen.
Hi. Sit down. Nice to meet you. So, how are you doing? Doing good? Let me clean the lens for you. So, this is travel, this is fun. You don't really like it? Okay, here we go. Fun is good. See, you cannot put horror on a girl. So, here goes me. All right. Let's go. Let's see if you can shoot this close. And here we go, jump.
Can you hear me?
Oh, sorry, wrong one. Did you like it? Say the
Turkish.
Çok
güzeldi. Çok güzel bir deneyimdi yani benim için. Gerçekten oradaymışım gibi hissettim. Hatta adam hani düştüğünde falan böyle tutmak için yani kendime çok gerçekçiydi. Çok güzeldi.
I think that was good. All right. Thanks a lot. Thank you very much. All right. Thank you very much. You feel free please to download our free app. It's available Jaunt VR app on Android and iPhone and you could just get that. Sorry? Can you repeat the horror film for her?
Yeah,
oh, the cameraman? Oh, no, we're just going to end because I think... Sorry?
No, getting... they want to see which horror movie you have been showing.
Oh,
so
okay.
We are going to follow
we'll
up with the camera.
Okay, we'll get another girl.
So we can try
we'll
with one more person.
We'll one more
is that
person.
Okay?
One, yeah,
but
we try
this
one
time
more.
A lady, please.
Okay.
A lady.
Girl over there. Come on up.
Yok, erkekler olmasın, bir bayan alalım isterseniz.
Now you get a Turkish girl.
We
get a Turkish girl for you.
We will take one lady for the horror movie. Evet, bu korku filmini bir de bir bayanlar üzerinde deneyelim, ondan sonra kapanışı yapalım kararı verdik. Bu esnada o görüntüleri sizlere de izleteceğiz.
You, no, you have to sit.
Really?
Yeah, you have to sit. Nice to meet you. I'm Michael. Nice to meet you, sweetie.
Siz korkmasanız da biraz çığlık falan atın lütfen. Ay, pardon, açıkmış, özür dilerim.
All right. Okay. You sitting comfortably? Just sit down. Cool. All right, let's go. Next one?
No.
Okay.
think they slipped us something. I'm gonna be back. I'm gonna get out.
Thank you.
Very much.
Did you like it?
Yes, I like very much, and it's really good experience for me.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Nice to meet
you. All right. So come by to the booth. We're there tomorrow and Saturday if you want to do a demo yourself. We're at the booth at the Dutch Pavilion. Make sure you come by and see us and see the other Dutch innovations. Thank you very much for your attention. Tessa Culler.